What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In this video, we are going to cover a first set of control statements, which consists of if conditions, if else's, and switch cases. First on the list is the if statement. When the if keyword is used, a condition is expected after it, and based on that condition, it is decided whether to execute the code inside the if block or not. If the condition provided is true, the code inside the if block is executed. Let's see this in action. In this code snippet, we are checking inside our if condition whether our variable is an even number. If it is the case, then we print out "I am even" on the screen. As you can see, the block of code inside the if condition only gets executed if the condition is true, which is the case when the variable is 4, but when the variable is equal to 5 or any other odd number, then the code block inside the if condition is skipped. In case we require another block of code to be executed only when the condition is false, the Java if-else statement can be used. The Java if-else statement also tests the condition inside the if statement. It executes the if block in case this condition is true. Otherwise, the else block is executed. We can also use the ternary operator to perform the task of an if-else statement. It is a shorthand way to check the condition. If the condition is true, the result of the question mark is returned. But if the condition is false, the result of the colon or two dots is returned. As you can see in this example, we are checking if the variable we have is even or odd. If it is even, we increment it by 1. If not, we increment it by 2. And using the ternary operator, the same exact behavior can be replicated. In our example, the variable is equal to 4, which is an even number. So the output in both the if-else and ternary operator will be 5. The if-else-if ladder statement executes one condition from multiple statements. So it will start by checking the condition in the if statement, and if it is false, it will check the condition in the next else-if statement, and so on until one of these conditions is true. If none of the conditions provided is resolved to true, then the code found in the else statement is executed. This is how the if-else-if ladder is represented in Java. So, as already mentioned, in order to execute the code present under condition 3, conditions 1 and 2 must be false, and condition 3 must be true. This is the only way to reach and execute this specific block of code. In this if-else-if ladder example, we are checking if the given variable, which in our case is fixed to 7, is multiple to either 2, 3, or 5. If it isn't the multiple of either of them, then geekific is printed out. And in this example, geekific is actually the output that will be printed out, as 7 is a prime number. Two if statements can be nested inside each other. After checking if the first condition resolves to true, we can go ahead, execute some code, and then call another if statement inside this first one. If the first condition is not met or is false, then the program won't even reach the second if statement to check its condition. In other words, the inner if block condition is tested only when the outer if block condition is true. Now, if no code execution is required between the two if statements, then the nested if statements can be reduced to a single one, with the AND operator separating both conditions, as you can see in front of you. In this Java example, you can see that if the given variable is a multiple of 2, we print out "I am a multiple of 2." But if and only if this variable is a multiple of 2, could we go ahead and check if it is also a multiple of 3? Which in our example is indeed the case. If the variable provided was 3 or 9, none of these two sentences will be shown on the screen, even though 3 and 9 are both multiples of 3. The next control statement we are going to discuss is the switch statement. The Java switch statement executes one statement from multiple conditions. It is like the if-else-if ladder statement, but with only equal conditions. The switch statement works with all primitive and wrapper types. In other words, the switch statement tests the equality of a variable against multiple values. We can have one or n number of case values in a switch expression. This is how the switch statement is represented in Java. In our example, we are checking if the expression is equal to value 1. If so, then the code inside the case 1 will be executed. You may also have noticed the break statements present after each code block. These are to ensure that only the piece of code present in the case 1 block will be executed. Because, you see, these break statements are optional, and the Java switch statement is fall through. So if the break statement is not present, the switch statement will execute all the code blocks after the first match. Let's take an example and consider that we have a switch statement with no breaks. And consider that, in our case, the expression matches the second value. So we will go ahead and execute the block of code that should be executed in this case. But on top of that, and because break statements do not exist, we will also execute all the block of codes corresponding to the statements that come after this case. So cases 3, 4, and all the way to the default case. Don't get me wrong, this isn't a bad thing. Sometimes we may require this behavior, but most of the times we don't. That is why you may have to pay attention to this. Another thing to note about switch statements is scope. All switch cases share the same scope. So if we were to define the same variable in two switch cases, our code will not compile and will tell us that this variable is already defined in the scope. What we can do to resolve this is use curly braces in each of our cases. When used, they will ensure that each case has a scope of its own. Before we continue, I want to make sure that we all know what enums are. So enums are basically classes with a fixed set of constants or variables that do not change at any point in time. They are mostly used when we want to enumerate a finite set of constants. And these enums turn out to be very convenient and powerful in switch statements, as you can see in this example. A case can be created for each constant of the enum, thus avoiding all possible comparison failures, which can be encountered in case of string comparisons per example. If you recall how we just wrote the switch statement, well, actually, that was one way of writing it. And that was the case prior to Java 12. I will be releasing future videos detailing all changes across the Java versions, but for now I will be only covering the differences and modifications the switch statement went through throughout these versions. First, multiple values can be put in the same case. So in our example, we are printing, the week is not over yet, in case we have a weekday, and in case we have a weekend, we are printing enjoy the weekend. Before Java 12, each weekday would have had to be written on a case separate from the others, but now all of them can sit within the same case. Another feature that was introduced in Java 12 and was greatly improved in Java 13 is the switch expression. This is what switch expressions look like in Java 13. You can notice that the new syntax uses the lambda operator, or this arrow, instead of the colon or two dots that we're used to use for switch statements. Also, there are no break keywords, and that's because the switch expression doesn't fall through cases as the switch statements do. Another addition is that now we should have comma delimited criteria between each of the cases. Going a bit further, there is a possibility to actually write as much code as we would like on the right side of these expressions. To do that, we will have to use the yield keyword. As you can see in this example, for the Thursday-Friday case, we expand our code block, and after we are done, we will yield the value we want our switch expression to return. Speaking of return, as we previously saw, we are allowed to return from inside a switch statement, but we are not allowed to return from inside a switch expression. So, the first example you can see is perfectly valid and will compile, but the second one will not compile, as we are trying to return outside of an enclosing switch expression. The last thing I want to cover about switch expressions is exhaustiveness. In switch statements, it doesn't really matter if all possible cases or scenarios are covered. Whereas, in switch expressions, we do have to cover every single one of them. In our examples, even though in the switch statements we haven't covered all the possible cases, our compiler does not complain. But take a look at the second example, which is a switch expression. The compiler will insist that all possible cases are covered. And until all of these cases are covered, either one by one or by using a default fallback case, like in the third example, this switch expression will not compile. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.